Hussain, the spirit behind this summit. Let me remove this. Can you hear me at the end, sir? Thank you. Asfar Hussain and Khalid Mansoor Bhai and Samad and Ambassador, it's a great privilege, and I don't think I'm equipped to really comment on what has been said. The two things been talked about, Society 5.0 and the CPAC. I have only two small comments to make, and I'll start from the second part, that's the Society 5.0. We all agree that the world today belongs to the infotech and the biotech and artificial intelligence, cloud computing, and of course, machine learning. And the countries and the companies who control the data, they will control the world. In corporate sense, of course, I'll again say that I'm not fractionally, but phenomenally falling short on to say something. We have some of the best corporate people sitting here, like Arshad Khan and Aftab Bhatt and everybody there. But my comment is that he's been perfectly spot on once he says on the people's contact. I believe we need to slightly go back. To my mind, the humans believe in stories. They don't believe in facts and data. So this could be a controversial statement where I'm going. But I'll prove it that what I feel is right. How is that, sir? You know, every person, every group, every nation has a story and the folklore and the myth to believe. At the global elite, say way back in the initial decade of last century, they dreamed themselves that there are three stories they believed in. It was a story of course, a fascist story, it was a communist story, it was a liberal stories. So they went on to believe in their stories, starting from 1910-15, and the first story which came was knocked out on the Second World War. So Second World War witnessed to emerging of a second story, a tussle between the government story and the liberal story. Went on for 40 years, from 40 to 30, and then came the buzzwords, of course, what we talked about between 1980 to 2021. That's a liberal story. So to my understanding, the story is failing. This story is not catching the attention of the young lot. I belong to early generations. How is this story failing now? Story is failing. This story is built upon on the concept of equality, the freedom, the liberty, and the foundation riding on the weaver success for technology. And what technology brings with it is all the ills and perils and promises been very rightly brought out by Smith. We live in that kind of environment. So what do we need to do is a very good question asked. Where do we go? The story, it's the Society 5.0. So where do we go from here? We need to give a story to our younger generation, which this century is not giving them. They're confused. We cannot even entirely comprehend the impact of all the technology disruption what we have, the infotech and the biotech and artificial intelligence. The first thing I'd like to recommend to the house is that people like Smad and all, they need to come out with a new story. The world needs to come out with a story to the people of the world. That's a missing link. And how did we start this? Because while we're talking on the international platforms, the things like freedom and the liberty, the human rights, so you started, of course, with the 9/11s and then the Afghanistan intervention, the Syria, the Libya, the Middle East, it all went on. And you came down to somewhere in 2008, once you had the financial, of course, meltdown of the world. So that wasn't working well. So end up having 60% people in Asia, about 15 in Africa, so about 25% people end up giving you stories. And they were telling the world to believe in those stories. That is creating disillusionment. And then, of course, come just a couple of years before the COVID came up, and you certainly learned that there are countries with the more state control, they did better. So in Australia, we have 117 cases in Melbourne, so the state is under lockdown. On the same day in London, you have 50,000 cases, and they lifted the ban. So that's a dichotomy we were working in. So that is where my first recommendation based on to this is that who gives a new story to the new generation? They are very competent people. It's a pleasure to have young leaders like him. So that's my first point. The second one I want to make is on the CPAC, basically. The CPAC, of course, I'm very glad to hear what Khalid has said. There have been controversies, there have been uncertainties being talked about it, and most of these been, of course, with a purpose. And I think they're well on the way, but I'll make two recommendations to him. I've been to Gwadar a couple of times. So you need to work on the water management and the power. Those two things missing there, this paradigm shift in the game changer is not going anywhere. We have a trouble there. The second part is on the security. It's my personal belief, you know, CPAC is one small component of the 60 countries being connected in the BRI. So it's not the only thing happening in the world. But we as a nation have been habit of, you know, pitching up things which do not even exist on grounds. We tell the world the CPAC is changing the destiny of this nation. We did that last 6 years. And where do we stand is, of course, with all the difficulties, the best part played by CPAC. We are on our track, but we need to not be in a panic. We need to slow down a bit and start boasting slightly lesser. So we'll be better off in what we do in about 10 years from now. I will also very strongly recommend to Khalid Mansoor that do have a look at it, going for the city clusters all over Pakistan with 11, 12 cities. And if you could make those island of success all over within Pakistan and have the ability to link up those, perhaps that could also be more useful for the CPAC as an authority. And it's all a very good omen for us that as we speak, the Chinese are almost closer to their 14th five-year plans. So if you can sync the development of the CPAC with those 14th five-year plan of China, we could probably do better onto this one. I'm mindful of the fact I can see us for getting impatient the time, so I wish I had more time to talk. But I'll very briefly talk in 2 minutes on WAPDA. I've been heading these organizations, WAPDA and KAPCO, and my reason of these two organizations of success has been people who work there. I have the privilege of having Aftabat as a CEO, and I have such a wonderful young lords in WAPDA. We were about 3 years before, we had 9 projects that were stalled for decades. Neelam Jhelum, Tribela 4, Kuram Tangi, Dasu, Basha, name a project stalled for years, for decades actually. The first thing we did was that we spoke to the people and they became the stakeholder, the very young people we picked up from the market. So we commissioned the 4 projects in 2 years and took the revenues of WAPDA to 100 billion rupees a year. Then we were supposed to do the projects like Bhasha and Momand and Dasu. These projects, ladies and gentlemen, are worth about $26 billion. We have kick-started these projects in about 2 years before. And you'll be glad to hear that the financial model of these is what you guys are more expert into this one. The first step we did was we tried to put our house in order. We went for the credit rating by all 3, Fitch, Moody's and S&P. And we became the first parastatal in Pakistan to have the stable outlook. And we also became the first company in Pakistan to go to the international market to sell ourselves out. And we end up launching the first Eurobond of Pakistan of $2.3 billion with the first benchmark of 500 with no government guarantee without any assets being pledged. So that's a kind of a success. The young team which I have to sit there, these people have been able to do a wonderful job, and they are part of the development of the stakeholders. So with that, we're having $14 billion Dhyamir Bhasha, $8 billion Dasu, and $3 billion is Mohammed. And in that, what the government will be able to chip in is not more than 20%. So that's all, of course, the commercial financing, and of course, we got the first $500 million, the private investment. And we have the model which talks of, the spiral carriers, the bride carriers, and also the domestic financing on this one. I wish we had some more time. Some other time we'll give you a more detailed brief on what WAPDA is doing. But I'd like to appreciate what Samad and Khalid Mansoor has said on CPAC. I wish all of them good luck, and it's a great pleasure to see young people taking this country to the next levels of development. My 3 points. First is we need to connect with the people. We need to give them a new story. This story is not working. The second is, of course, made 2 recommendations to CPAC onto this one. And thirdly, I'm grateful and delighted to be here. Thank you, Asfar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, General Muzammil, and thanks for the time management. My request to Irfan Wahab Khan, CEO Telenor, please join us here. Where is Irfan? And present the book to our speaker, Mr. Khalid Mansoor. Gentlemen. Now, Ambassador Dahmana Hashmi. Thank you. Thank you, Irfan. My request to Shandana Gulzar Khan. She is Member National Assembly. Please join us here to present the book to our speakers, Samad Daud and Waqarul Islam. Also, Waqarul Islam, please. Thank you, Shandana. And now, my request to Amir Ibrahim, CEO Jazz, to please join us here and present the book to General Muzammil Hussain, Chairman of WAPDA. He's also the chairman of CAPCO, and my very dear friend, Aftab Mahmood Bird, is also here. He's the CEO of CAPCO, doing amazing work, commendable work since last many years. Thank you. And one photograph, please, group photograph, please join us here. Irfan and Shandana, you will also join us, please.